Thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you for coming. I'm delighted to be able to speak with you today. My laboratory's research interest at the University of Virginia is on the gap between values and practices, what we think we should do, what we're trying to do, and what we actually do in our everyday behavior. And what I'd like to talk to you today about is a practical application of that interest, which is the gap between scientific values and scientific practices, how we idealize science to operate, how we think it should be operating, and how it does in everyday practice, and what are the causes of that gap, and then what kinds of things might we do to try to align the daily practice of science more with the values that we aspire science to exist by. Most of this discussion will be through the activities that we have at the Center for Open Science. And just to give you a little bit of information about the center, it is an independent nonprofit. It's not directly affiliated with the University of Virginia. I have appointments in both. And it's a technology company that aims as a mission to increase openness, integrity, and reproducibility of research. It has a staff of, it is a spin-out of my laboratory and now has a staff of 80 people. We were founded in 2013. And most of the work that happens there, about three quarters of the staff, is technology and infrastructure development, it's a software team. I'll only get into that toward the end. What I wanted to spend most of our time on is on the motivation for even having a Center for Open Science and why we think these issues need to be tackled and can be addressed in ways that can improve the outcomes and the efficiency of knowledge accumulation that science exists to do for the public good. So, but as we start in this, we have to first think, if we're going to address the gap between values and practices, first we need to think of what are the values of science. And there are many people have discussed what the values and norms of science, but one of the principal descriptions of it comes from Robert Merton, the sociologist of science, who in the 1940s and 50s identified what he saw as the core percepts of what makes science science. And a lot of these apply to scholarship more generally. And you'll see some applicability across scholarship, not just limited to the sciences, especially when we get into the technology and what we're trying to do to transform scholarly communication. But that can be a discussion that we have later. So let me start with Merton's norms that he identified for science. The first was communality, the open sharing of information. When I make a scientific claim, you don't believe it just because I make it and it sounds good. The way it comes to be credible or believed is based on the availability of the evidence supporting that claim. So I have to describe to you the methodology. I show you the data that was acquired with that methodology, the process of inference that I used to decide what was learned from that data, and that is the basis of belief in the claim, as opposed to a counter norm of secrecy, where I just say, you just have to trust me. Right? Science also has a norm of universalism, that the research is evaluated based on its own merit. The evidence itself is the basis for the credibility of the evidence, rather than the counter-norm of particularism. Right? We decide whether to believe a claim based on the reputation of the person making the claim. So we don't believe Newton's laws of mechanics are excellent theories of how mechanics work because he was Newton. We believe it because of the evidence supporting those laws. Disinterestedness. Researchers are motivated by knowledge and discovery versus the counter norm of self-interestedness. We treat science as a competition, trying to get ahead of the person down the hall. Merton also talked about organized skepticism. We consider all new evidence, even against our prior work as researchers, versus the counter norm, where I invest my career promoting my own theories, my own findings, defending them against the attackers in the research community. So those are the four norms identified by Merton, but others have talked about a variety of others, and the most prominent additional norm that has been discussed is the norm of quality over the norm of quantity as a counter norm. So these may be familiar, but the question is obviously, do scientists actually subscribe to these norms? Do they agree that these are principles of science, the norms or versus the counter norms? So Anderson and her colleagues did a study to try to assess whether scientists agree with the norms versus the counter norms. And what I'm showing you here is a cumulative plot of the survey respondents. So they surveyed about 3,300 NIH awardees in the US, where early career is defined as people who are in postdoctoral type positions, and mid-career are people who are in their first R01 award, which the average age is around 40 years old. And so what you're seeing here is in gray is the cumulative percentage of the sample that agreed with the norms over the counter norms on average. They said that the norms of science, openness, self-skepticism, communality are the things that they agree with over the counter norms, particularism, dogmatism, secrecy. So more than 90% of early and mid-career participants or researchers agreed with those norms of science, endorsed those norms. Whereas in black are the people that endorse the counter norms over the norms, right? Very few people did. And the gray hatches are people who said, I agree with both of these about the same degree. So then Anderson and her colleagues said, okay, that's fine. Don't tell me what you endorse. Tell me how you behave. Do you behave by the norms of science or by the counter norms of science? And this is what they observed. So still most people report behaving by the norms of science. But more people acknowledge that those counter norms also have influence in their behavior. Still, very few are saying that they behave according to the counter norms over the norms of science. So then Anderson and her colleagues said, that's fine, that's fine. Don't tell me what you do. Tell me what the other people in your research community, what they do in their practice. And this is what it looks like. So researchers endorse these as the norms of science, how science should operate. They largely perceive themselves as meeting those norms of science, and they don't think that their communities around them behave the same way, right? A common perception is that scientists are in it for themselves, in it to advance and defend their careers, and not necessarily living by the percepts of science that are better for the quality, the accuracy, the advancement of science and the knowledge accumulated. And that is a big perceptual gap. It is the same people, right? The people that are saying, I believe in the norms of science are simultaneously perceiving that the others in their community are not behaving according to those norms, at least in the aggregate. So for us, the core challenge that leads to that perceptual gap and other challenges in the gap between values and practices is that the incentives for my success as a practicing researcher are focused on me getting it published, not on me getting it right. So the currency of science is publication, right? The more that I publish and the higher prestige the outlets I publish in, the more likely I am to get a job, the more likely I am to keep that job, and the more likely I am to survive and thrive in the field. And as a consequence, if there are particular selection pressures as to what gets into journals, what is published, and particularly what is published in prestigious outlets, then I'm more likely to do behaviors that obtain those kinds of results that allow me to get those outcomes and not necessarily pursue those results that don't do that. So what is more likely to get published? Right? A novel result is more likely to get published than a redundant or a replication of a prior result. Right? A positive result, finding a relationship between two things, or finding that an experimental treatment has an impact on some outcome, is more likely to get published than a negative result, finding that these two things are not related, or that this treatment has no effect on that outcome. And clean and tidy results, where everything fits together into a single story, are more likely to get published than stories with exceptions, errors, things that don't quite fit, explanations that don't quite account for all of the data. So a novel, positive, clean story is more likely to be published, primarily because it is better, right? If you can get a novel finding with positive evidence in a clean, tidy explanation with all the evidence supporting it, you've hit the jackpot. That's a great thing. The challenge is that doesn't happen very often in the laboratory, right? In the lab, things are messy. There's lots of uncertainty. There are things that don't quite work. And the reason that happens is because we're studying things we don't understand. That's why we study them. And so progress is halting, it's differentiated, and all of that mess is part of the discovery process that gets resolved over time. The uncertainty reduces as we continue to investigate. But the incentives are still very much on get that positive, novel, clean story. And at the same time, because I need certain kinds of results to succeed, then I have opportunity in the progress of doing my research in the lab to make those results look more beautiful, more positive, more novel, than might be representative of the research as we do it in the laboratory. And that opportunity creates a conflict of interest between what's in my interest as a practicing scientist to get published, to get in prestigious outlets, and what's good for the science, which is representing as accurately and clearly as possible what we're learning and failing to learn as we do that process. So that creates a difficult challenge. And there have been many methodologists that have talked about what are the things that occur that reduce the credibility or the reliability of the science that's in the literature compared to how it could be. Right? And we'll just summarize these very briefly. One is low power research. Right? Across many fields, the experimental designs themselves do not have sufficient power to reliably detect the effects positively as frequently as they are observed. More than 90% of results across most disciplines are positive results in the literature. And yet, in most estimates of power of those findings to detect those results, the average power in the literature is 50% or less. So what that means is, if everything that was in the published literature were true, then we would expect the positive result rate to be about 50%, because that's what the power is to detect those results. And yet the published literature shows 90% or more in most fields, positive results, suggesting that there's something of a gap, right? Something is more likely to get through the publication pipeline than other things. So there's also flexibility in analysis. When I get a data set, there are many choices I can make for how to treat that data to come to the inference that I make at the end. And those different choices have implications for what the outcomes are. And if some of those choices lead to outcomes that are more publishable than others, I may find very good reasons to value the publishable outcomes, to think that those are the better ways to analyze the data than the outcomes that don't look as good for me for publication. Simultaneously, we do many more experiments in the lab than we publish. And so we have choices that we make as we're doing our experiments of which things are going to get into the papers and ultimately into the literature if they can get through peer review. And so we have selective reporting. Some of the things that we do are not reported. And if there's any selection pressure, for example, if I'm more likely to leave out things that don't quite fit the story, then the published result is going to look more credible, look cleaner, look more beautiful than the reality of what we did in the laboratory, the things that we actually learned. And we are incentivized to ignore the nulls because those are less publishable. So only the positive results get in, leading to that inflated rate of positive results in the literature. And finally, there is very few incentives for replication. It isn't in my interest to try to increase understanding the credibility of a published result or even a result that I have produced, because the pressure is on innovation and novelty. Because innovation is more exciting than replication. We are pushing the boundaries out. That's where progress gets made in science. And replication feels like the grunt work of science, right? Just cleaning up the mess as we go of seeing which of those things can survive and thrive later. But innovation with no verification leads to a very difficult, a very unlikely process to actually have a solid standing. Now, all of these are issues that were identified by methodologists in 1950s, 60s, and 70s. So they are not new issues, and they have been strong critiques about the credibility of the published literature since that time. And yet, they are the same issues that are coming up in the conversations that have been occurring over the last 4 and 5 years about reproducibility across all scientific disciplines. So I just want to give a couple of examples to illustrate some of these challenges. We could go spend the whole time on unpacking those, but I just want to give a few so that we have some common understanding. And this is one example of a study that we did where we asked 29 independent teams to investigate the same research hypothesis. And the hypothesis was that players with darker skin tone in soccer would be more likely to get red cards than players with lighter skin tone. So we had the 29 different teams investigate that question, and these are the 29 different results that they observed across the with the circles. So if there is no effect, no relationship between skin tone and likelihood of red card, the estimates are near the dark, the darkest black line on the x-axis, equally likely. Positive values up the y-axis are indicators of a positive effect, meaning darker skin tone more likely to receive a red card. The estimated effect sizes are the circles, and the 95% confidence interval are the rectangles around that circle. So in traditional null hypothesis significance testing, you would consider it to be a positive result if the confidence interval does not include zero, the equally likely. And so the ones in green are those that were positive results. The ones in gray are those that are negative results or null results. So if you look across the 29 teams, you'll see that about two-thirds of the teams found a positive result, when a third of the teams found a null result, and a substantial variation in the likelihoods. Now, that happens all the time in research. Different researchers are doing different studies, and they find different estimates, and the most credible estimate might be the aggregate of those. But the twist in this study was that they all had the same data set. So we gave them the hypothesis to test and the data set on which they could use to test it. And those teams all had having substantial expertise in analytic methods for this kind of data made different choices. They had different models that they used, different exclusion criteria, different ways of aggregating the data, different ways of doing the estimates that led to different outcomes of the same data. When we look at papers in the published literature, we're not often thinking what we usually think is those are the findings that are produced by that data. But that's not correct. Those are the findings produced by that data conditional on the choices that the researchers made of how to analyze that data. And we don't see what the variation could have been if other choices, all reasonable choices, were made on how to analyze that data. And that has implications for the robustness, the interpretability of those particular findings, particularly if there are incentives for those researchers to treat some kinds of analysis approaches as more credible than other types. Okay, so that's one example. A second example comes from the Compare Trials Project, which is a collaboration of Ben Goldacre and others, where they went to pre-registered clinical trials. So clinical trials have to be pre-registered by law for the production of drugs or other interventions to get into clinical medicine. And what they did was they looked at the registered trials in registries like clinicaltrials.gov and compared those to what was reported in the published article about that pre-registered trial. And they examined 67 trials. You can look at the details at the website listed here below. And they found that 9 trials were perfect. And what perfect means in this context is that all of the outcomes identified in the pre-registration were outcomes reported in the article at the end of the study, things that they found. What they also observed is that there were 354 outcomes that were in the pre-registration that were not reported in the article at the end. And they found that there were 357 new outcomes that weren't in the pre-registration, but were reported in the published article. So in the small text, you can see on average, each trial reported just 58.2% of its specified outcomes, and each trial silently added 5.3 new outcomes. So outcomes were switching from what was planned at the outset to what was reported at the end. Now, it's possible that that was random, that outcomes happened to be switched somehow and there was no bias in how those outcomes were switched. It's also possible that there was a selection bias. Certain kinds of outcomes that looked better for the intervention, for the drug, for whatever else, might have been more likely to get into the article, and ones that looked less good for publishability and for the outcome might have been less likely to be reported. They didn't follow up to examine that in this particular study. But there are other studies that have followed up to look at that. And so this one by Annie Franco and her colleagues did just that. They went to an opportunistic sample in the social and behavioral sciences, which is a program called TESS, Time Series Experiments in the Social Sciences. And what TESS is it maintains a representative sample of US adults. And any researchers in the social sciences that want to access that, which is a very valuable sample, hard to access and maintain, they can apply to be able to run an experiment on that sample. And in the application process, they have to spell out their entire protocol, exactly what they're going to do in that study, because when it's accepted, the TESS group takes that protocol and implements it, collects the data, and then returns the data to the original team. But a requirement of using the test data set, resources, is that the protocols are made public and the data are made public. So the researchers get first dibs at it, but then all of it has to be made available. So Franco and her team did the same kind of comparison. What was in the protocol, what's pre-registered as what they were going to do, and then what actually appears in the paper that that team wrote and published in the end. And so what you're seeing on the left side is the number of experimental conditions, the number of randomizations in that study. On the x-axis is that we're actually in the data collection, and on the y-axis is that we're reported in the article. So if every experimental condition of the studies were reported in the article, then they should all be on the diagonal line. But what they found is that 40% of the studies left out at least one of the experimental conditions that was in the study, didn't note that that manipulation had occurred. They also followed up and looked at the outcome measures with the same idea. On the x-axis, the number of outcome measures that were actually collected in the study, and on the y-axis, the number of outcome measures that are reported in the final paper. And 70% of the articles left out one or more of the outcomes that was actually administered in the study when they were reporting the paper. Now again, that could be random, but they did in this case have access to the data, so they followed up and looked at the data to see if there was a difference between what was kept in and what was left out. And what they found was that for the tests that were reported, the median p-value was 0.02, and in standard practice for null hypothesis significance testing, you would consider p less than 0.05 as being a significant result, a positive outcome. The median effect size in Cohen's d units is 0.29, which is roughly 0.3 standard deviations. And the percent of those reported tests that were less than 0.05 is 63%. By comparison, the ones that were left out, the median p-value was 0.35, the median effect size was 0.13, and only 23% of them were significant positive results. So this suggests that there was a selection bias. Results that were negative or weaker were less likely to appear in the paper than the positive results, despite the fact that they were run. And so as a consequence, the publication looks more positive, looks like there's more evidence for the phenomena under study, than the actual evidence provides in the data itself. So one more example, again back to clinical trials. And this is an initial study by Robert Kaplan and Veronica Irvin, where they took large clinical trials from the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, one of NIH's institutes. And they wanted to compare those trials from before pre-registration was required in clinical trials, so 2000, pre-2000, with clinical trials that were that after pre-registration was required for clinical trials after 2000. And so they looked at those, that comparison of what's the rate of positive results before pre-registration is required, saying in advance what the outcomes are, versus after when you have to say what the primary outcomes are. And what they observed is that the positive result rate dropped from 57% prior to pre-registration being required, making a commitment to your outcomes, to 8% after pre-registration was required. So that is a substantial decline. And it doesn't mean necessarily that people are moving, changing the goalposts of what the outcome measure of interest is prior to pre-registration to find a positive outcome to a negative outcome. It could mean that. It could also mean that after 2000, they just didn't have things to find anymore. They basically finished doing the research of stuff that they could find, and so that went away. We can't distinguish between those possibilities in this data because it's a naturalistic data set. But Bob and Veronica are following up on this initial study with a more larger census review of NIH trials pre- and post-registration to see if the same pattern emerges across different areas of research. Okay, so those are some challenges, and they suggest a number of barriers to try to address the challenges that might make the published literature look more beautiful than reality would suggest based on the data. A first barrier is those perceived norms that we started with. if I perceive that most of the research community around me is doing things to advance their careers, even at the cost of the values and norms of science, then I am put in an awkward position. Right? Either I can embrace my values and live by those, and consequently perhaps not have a career because I'm disadvantaged about advancing myself, or I can recognize what the realities of the marketplace are and start to practice some of those value, some of those practices in order to have a career in science. Right? That's a very difficult situation for any researcher to be in. A second barrier is that we have these amazing frontal lobes that once we are confronted with data where we have a stake in it, we are much more likely to find outcomes that are in our interest to actually be the right way to do it than outcomes that are not in our interest. And we won't necessarily even recognize that we are, instead of reasoning, rationalizing, because it's very hard to observe those processes happening in our own minds. Instead, we will think that we are coming up with the best reasons to say that that analysis strategy is actually the right one opposed to that one. And in fact, that study that I just ran that got a negative result really was actually a terrible study. I don't know why I ran that in the first place. I should just ignore it. It is methodologically horrible. Who would run a study like that? That's ridiculous. And that feels very compelling because I can look at things, I can identify things. Whereas if it comes out positive, I say, this is the best study anybody's ever done. I can't believe no one ever thought of doing this study except for me. This is great. So that's very difficult because we have a stake in it. Third, that happens with minimal accountability. You don't know what happens in my lab. All you see are the reports that come out in the end of my characterization of what we did in our laboratory. And so I don't have the occasion to do perspective taking when we're in the process of collecting our data, of analyzing our data, of writing the report of those data. I don't have the opportunity, the thought, to perspective take. What would someone who is observing me do this think about whether this is appropriate or not? And without that perspective taking, I may not recognize that some of the choices that I make are ones that I might not make, or at least might not want others to see me make, if they were able to see that process. That lack of transparency then means I can much more easily justify different behaviors for myself that I wouldn't justify in a public setting. And then finally, I'm busy, and so are you. So even if we embrace the values, or say we're going to do that despite the norms being different in the discipline, even if I say I want to make sure that I have accountability, I want to do practices that are more transparent, that are more skeptical about my own results, that sounds like it's going to take a lot of work. And I don't have time for doing all of that extra work because we're busy. We're doing a lot of interesting research. And so adding things to that workflow, adding more things that I have to do is another way to quit more quickly end my career rather than giving me the opportunity to live by my values and still succeed in science. So those are rather daunting barriers, but they're not unovercomable. I don't know if that's a word. But anyway, we'll go with it. So at what our goal is at the Center for Open Science is trying to figure out how is it that we can nudge the incentives in the scientific community to be able to enable researchers to be able to live by the values that they already have, as we saw in the opening slide. They want to be open. Researchers do want to be reproducible. They value skepticism. They're just not rewarded for it in the scientific process as it happens today. So what the basis of reward can be, we can do a cartoon version of the model for this, right? The main means of my success are on the outcomes of my research, particularly on obtaining novel, positive, clean outcomes. And what that produces are the rewards, which are primarily through publication. And through publication comes opportunities for more publication, for more grants, for job security, and any other rewards of research. And so when we have a model where the primary means is based on the outcomes of the research, then all of my efforts need to be to obtain the best kind of outcomes in order to obtain the rewards. So what can we do to address that model? Well, one obvious intervention is to add additional means. So instead of simply rewarding people for the outcomes of their work, we can also generate incentives that reward on process, how they do their research, regardless of the outcomes that are observed. So practicing transparently, producing results that are reproducible, are more about how it is that the research is done, whatever the outcomes. Likewise, we can add additional things to reward. Rather than it singularly being about the publication, rewards could also be on the other elements of scholarship. The data that are produced are a scholarly object. They are a contribution that the researcher has made to generate those data. And so if the researcher can get credit for those data, or that those materials, or that protocol that they designed, or the methodology in a bigger scope, or the code that they created, if those become citable units of things to acknowledge and reward themselves, then it's not just about the publication, it's also about the components of the process of arriving at that publication, of the content that was used to generate that publication. We will not get rid of reward for outcomes, and there's good arguments to make that we shouldn't. Researchers who find amazing things and discover amazing new things that lead science in new directions will be rewarded more than scientists who find nothing at all. But we can create additional rewards for process, because very few of us are going to change the discipline. Most of us are going to contribute in ordinary ways, but important ways, to the accumulation of knowledge in a step-by-step basis. And a lot of that is through having excellent process of generating credible, reliable knowledge that others can make use of and build on themselves. So I want to talk about a few examples of things that we've been doing to try to nudge those incentives so that researchers are rewarded more for process and for the content in addition to the outcomes. So I'll just give a few different examples, and then when we're in discussion, we can talk about more aspects. I'm going to focus at first on those examples that are in publication as that core unit of currency. But we can also talk about nudges and incentives that are relevant in the funding process, in the institutional process, in societies, et cetera. So the first example is signals. In this case, badges. So a journal might decide that we want to create some incentive for researchers to make the data underlying the article available in a repository, or to make their materials, what it is they used in order to create that data or apply to that data in order to get some outcomes, or that they pre-registered, they made commitments in advance to what their design was and how they were going to analyze that data as a credibility stamp for following through with their initial commitments. So badges are silly, they're a small thing, but they are a signal, and there's a lot of very good evidence that signals are easy ways to communicate value, communicate intentions, communicate what people are doing without having to do a whole lot extra. So we use signals all the time in the kind of car we drive, the kind of clothes that we wear, the bumper stickers that we put on vehicles. Well, maybe that's only an American thing, I don't know. But signals are a means of transmitting information. And so a journal offering this as a signal is the journal saying that we value this as a concept. It's a good thing to share data and materials and to show if you've pre-registered. And researchers, if they care to meet the criteria to get those badges, are signaling that they value that enough in order to do it. And putting that signal on the paper is a trivial but a real acknowledgement that they went ahead and did that behavior. Whereas in the current landscape, there is no evidence of that behavior at all. So the question is something that trivial, just an acknowledgement that that practice is happening, enough to change people's behavior? So we did a study to evaluate that. The journal Psychological Science, which is a premier outlet in psychology, adopted badges on January 1st, 2014. And so we evaluated data for the 2 years prior and a year and a half post that adoption of badges. And what I'm showing you here is the percent of articles on the y-axis reporting that data was available in a repository that supported the report in that article. And the Psychological Science is the dark black line, and the gray lines are four comparison journals, similar journals in psychology that did not adopt badges at the same time. So what you can see is that the average sharing rates are below 10%. Psychological Science, only about 3% of the articles on average prior to 2014, which is where the data stopped, are sharing data. So then badges are introduced in 2014, and this happens. So by the first half of 2015, 39% of the articles published in Psychological Science have data in a repository. Right? 13-fold increase for a trivial, really trivial intervention. Just putting a little badge on there saying where the data are and just giving people the option to apply for that. Why does that have such an impact? It's not that badges are brilliant and actually everybody is dreaming of going back to Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts. It's simply that that is already valued. Right? People value openness and they get no credit for it today, but if there's a way to signal that credit, then the extra effort that's involved in making that data available or those materials available or whatever is sufficient to initiate the behaviors relevant to that value. And so this is one where we think if journals adopt this more broadly, we can address a lot of open data challenges simply by appealing to values that people already possess. This isn't a persuasion case where people don't want to do the behavior. We need to teach them actually seatbelts are safer. It's not actually so good to be thrown from the car to be away from the crash. You should wear a seatbelt. You had to educate people and persuade them that that was the case. This is one where the value is already there. All you need to do is provide opportunity for people to be able to get some credit for that, some public acknowledgement of it. Okay. A second one was mentioned in the introduction, which is just defining for all of us what are the guidelines for being more transparent and reproducible in our work. What are the things that one does to do that? And that has both an education function and a setting of standards function. These are the expectations, these are the norms of how science operates, that combat those perceptual gaps and instead say, no, our funders and our journals all expect these things from us. And so we had a group that gathered to collect all of the work that had been done by many groups on what are the standards for transparency, what things need to be shared, how do they need to be shared, under what conditions should they not be shared, intellectual property, privacy rules, et cetera, and generated a set of guidelines called the TOP guidelines, and there's the address for it. All these slides will be available publicly. It would be ironic if I didn't do that. So you will be able to access all of that information later. But the guidelines are 8 different guidelines that are different aspects of transparency that funders or journals can adopt for expectations of their grantees or authors for what the requirements of those journals are. And they're at 3 different levels because different fields are at different places in thinking about things like data sharing or pre-registration. And so level 1 is just an explicitness expectation. The journal expects that if the data are available, you report where. And if the data are not available, you report that they are not available. And you can say why if you want to. That's a minimum standard of expectations for transparency. Just say whether it's available or not. A second level is a requirement. This journal or this funder expects that as a condition of publication or of funding that you will make the data available in a repository and you need to show that you did that. Then level 3 is a verification. Not only do we expect it, we will follow up and get that data and have an independent group see if they can reproduce the findings that you reported in the article. So different levels may be appropriate or less appropriate depending on the resources and the interests and the norms that are currently existing in different areas of science. But the TOP guidelines are generally applicable. Any area of research can use those and adapt them for standardizing those norms. And so far, this has been successful in generating some common understanding across a variety of different groups. So there are 749 journal signatories, and by becoming a signatory, a journal is saying that they will conduct a review to decide what levels and which ones of the guidelines that they will adopt, as are 62 organizations. And I pulled out some illustrative ones here so you can find your favorite society or discipline or journal to see if they're there. So that's a second relatively easy thing to do because it doesn't cost very much. It just requires some expression of what the standards are and providing groups an opportunity to have those norms be pervasive norms across research disciplines. So I want to talk about a third one that may be much less familiar to many of us, but is prominent in particularly in clinical trials. And that is thinking about the 2 different modes of research that happen. And philosophers of science have lots of different terminologies for this. But the One mode, we might consider the context of justification. When I'm in the context of justification, I have a hypothesis. My theory is this. I can derive specific hypotheses that lead to expectations in this experimental context. What will the outcomes be? And so when I'm in that mode, I am actively testing a pre-existing idea, right? And what I need to do is define that idea and the expectations of the outcome prior to observing the outcomes, because the data that are produced are a way to confront that idea, to test whether that idea survives empirical scrutiny. And so the choices that are made in a confirmatory analysis model is independent of the data. You don't get to know the data when you're making those commitments because you need it to be an active test, an active confrontation of that hypothesis in advance. So that occurs sometimes. And what occurs a lot of times is the context of discovery, where I don't have a strong theoretical expectation. I don't have derived hypotheses for what ought to occur in this case. Instead, I'm doing the study in order to discover. I have lots of uncertainty. I don't know what's going to happen. And so I am adventuring. I'm using the data as a means of generating hypotheses that I can test later in new experiments. And this is a vitally important part of research because our models don't anticipate all of the outcomes that we observe. Most breakthroughs and innovations happen accidentally as a discovery. When we get into data and we're surprised by something that's very different than what our prior expectations are. So both of these models, the context of confirmation and the context of exploration, are vitally important in science. But what's also vitally important is to know when you're doing one or the other. And the purpose of pre-registration is to make that distinction clear. So what happens in pre-registration is that you specify in advance what you are doing in the context of justification. If you are actively going to test a hypothesis, then you have to specify what that hypothesis is, what the methodology is, and how you will analyze that data in order to evaluate that hypothesis. Then, once that is specified, you do those analyses, and that's the confirmatory analysis. You have robust inference. Everything else that's done with the data is exploration. And that's generative for the next studies that one might do. The reason that this is important is that in statistical inference, p-values are interpretable in the context of confirmation, and they are not in the context of discovery. And the reason that that is that p-values are only interpretable if you know all of the conditions under which those p-values are generated. And as soon as you observe the data, then you no longer know all of the conditions under which the different tests that you choose are done. Because once I'm informed by the data, I make different choices about how I could analyze that data, what inferences I might draw from that data. And as a consequence, the possible analyses that I would have done had I not looked at the data are unknown. And p-values depend on knowing the full set of analyses so that you can do error control. If I'm only going to do one test and I define that test up front, then my p-value is directly diagnostic of the likelihood of observing that outcome. If I do 10 tests and I define them up front, then I can do error control of what proportion of those p-values would I expect to be below 0.05 by chance. As soon as I do not know how many tests I might have done because I'm being influenced by the data in order to decide what analyses to do, then I don't know how many tests there could have been. And so p-values no longer have meaning. And so the consequence of this is that if we present exploratory analyses as confirmatory, we increase the publishability of results at the cost of the credibility of the results. And how would this happen? Well, it happens because when I'm in the dynamic exchange of examining my data and analyzing it and coming up with inferences, I may be convincing myself that this is what I expected all along. This is the analysis that I would have done, not having seen the data. And I'm incentivized to write a paper as if I had anticipated it all along, to tell that story as if I was a genius and thought of this amazing interaction, this unexpected left turn, and then how it all comes together and then arrives this way, because that's how great papers are written, rather than acknowledging them as unexpected discoveries, things that I didn't anticipate. And so the pre-registration, the key of it, is to make clear when we're in one mode or the other. So just to illustrate how we operate, we now pre-register all research in our lab. And how we do that is that we define an analysis plan up front, And we put that analysis plan on our infrastructure, the Open Science Framework, I'll talk about that later, as what we're doing this study for. Sometimes that's very simple because we have very little expectations. We're going into a new area, we have an initial idea of why we're going into that area, but mostly we're going to do exploratory work. So we pre-register that, and we know we have good error control on at least those tests. Then we get the data, we do those analyses, and then we say, okay, open the floodgates, and we move into exploratory mode. And we do lots and lots and lots of analyses to learn what we can from those data to generate new hypotheses about how that phenomenon might actually be working. And all of that are hypotheses that then inform the next experiment, that we then pre-register those hypotheses that we think are the most promising for confirmatory tests, and back and forth and back and forth. But the value of that pre-registration, defining it up front, is so that we don't forget what it is we thought the study was for. And we have those commitments and that external dependence that we can rely on to know that when I return to this data set 6 months later, and my most common response when a graduate student comes to my office with a data set that we, of a study we designed 6 months ago, is, what is that? And they have to explain what the study was. Why did we do that study? Well, this is why we did that study. Oh, that's a great idea. Well, I'm glad we did. Yeah. So that is a check for us for our own interests. So I'll return, because pre-registration is not so familiar to men, especially in the basic sciences, but I'll return to this positive result rate that changed in clinical trials from prior to pre-registration being required to after pre-registration was required, right? A drop from 57% positive result rate to 8%. So a question that we asked ourselves in the laboratory when we were first thinking about this is, would we be okay with receiving treatment based on clinical trials that were not pre-registered, where the researchers might have switched the outcomes in order to be more likely to obtain positive results and get that drug or that treatment approved? Is that something okay for us to administer to ourselves or people we love or my kids? Right? No, most people will say, that's not okay. So then the question is it okay for us in our basic science lab to not pre-register our research? And the first objection that comes up very intuitively is, oh yeah, but our research isn't that important. Now, if we're willing to make that argument, then we should not object when the vice chancellor says your funding is cut because your research is not that important. You just said so, right? Of course, my opinion is basic research is vitally important. Basic research is the basis for what ends up being things that turn into unexpected ways in which we can do create new things, have new applications that will serve the public interest in the long term. But if I'm going to embrace that, then I also have to embrace this as a standard that is difficult for me to argue myself out of, that pre-registration is a means with which I can increase the credibility of the research that is a hypothesis test coming out of the laboratory and can be very direct and open about what is exploratory and it should be inspiring new investigations into the future. So because this is unfamiliar to many, we started a challenge called the Pre-Registration Challenge. There's the address. And if you go there, what you will find is a whole lot of information. Really, this is awareness and education campaign. You'll find a whole lot of information about what pre-registration is, why it is of value, links to articles that detail investigations about pre-registration and its impact, and how to do it, and how to do it efficiently. Because the most daunting challenge for most artists think, well, that sounds interesting, but that sounds like a heck of a lot of work. And we do experiments pretty quickly in our lab. Or we have very large data collections that happen over 10 years. Pre-registration can't possibly be relevant for that. But it is relevant for that. And there are ways to do this and to do it very efficiently. In fact, in our lab, and if you want to talk about it in Q&A, we think we've actually gotten more efficient with our process by doing this planning up front, because we identify errors that we wouldn't have identified until after we did the experiment by doing a more rigorous planning. And the key in the pre-registration challenge in terms of incentive is that if you enter the pre-registration challenge, there's a workflow that guides you through how to pre-register your research and what things you might specify in that process. And there's $1 million put aside for the first 1,000 researchers get $1,000 rewards for publishing the outcomes of pre-registered research. So $1,000, that's like 17 euro. So you can buy like a sandwich and a coffee or something with that. So that we perceived as a means of providing just enough incentive to think, ah, that's something that's interesting. Maybe I will try it in order to engage that challenge. And our hope is that by experiencing it, there is an opportunity for critical evaluation. Does this actually provide value in the workflow in our laboratory? And do we feel more confident about the results as we do it? And I'll note that doing the pre-registered analysis during a lab meeting and having it all revealed for everybody in the room is really fun. So that's a plug for trying this. And, you know, devastating for the grad student, but it's really fun. It was really fun. Okay, so I want to talk about one more of these and then talk more about the infrastructure I haven't talked about at all, and that's registered reports. So here's the cartoon of how research gets done and communicated. Right? We design a study, we collect and analyze the data, we write a report, and then we publish it. But of course, it's not that simple because there's this big thing in the way between writing the report and publishing it, which is peer review. All the incentives in the standard model are to make that report as beautiful as possible in order to get through peer review, because peer review is the enemy in that case for the goal that one has, especially reviewer two, in order to publish that outcome, because that's the thing that I need. Registered reports changes one thing in this process, and that is to move peer review to after the design phase. So the researcher writes up the research question, why it's important, writes out the methodology, writes out the analysis plan for how that question will be tested, and submits that to the journal for peer review. The journal decides, is that an important enough question that we need to know the answer, and is that methodology effective enough to evaluate it so that the answer will be informative, regardless of outcome, because the study hasn't been done yet. So if the journal review process agrees, that's a study worth doing and that's an effective methodology, then they give in principle acceptance then, before knowing the results. And as long as the research process follows through with the design specified, right, and you can have positive controls to show that, in fact, you did an effective experiment, because if you're doing neuroimaging and you forgot to turn the magnet on, then it isn't really, you didn't actually do the test. So you have to demonstrate at the second stage of review after the report that you did follow through and do the experiment effectively. But those evaluations are independent of the outcomes. The reviewers are not allowed to decide to accept or reject at stage two based on the outcomes, only based on follow-through of the design and the appropriateness of the conclusions given the evidence provided. So this dramatically changes the incentives for the researcher. Right? No longer do I have to make the report as beautiful as possible, the outcomes. What I need to do is make the methodology as beautiful as possible, make the questions as important as possible. And those are the things that I control and that I'm supposed to be able to control, right? Through insight, innovation, creativity, I come up with the best possible questions and the best possible ways to evaluate those questions. And the one thing I'm not supposed to be able to control are the outcomes. And yet right now, the outcomes are everything. And instead, we can reward without knowing what those outcomes are to align what we're supposed to be using our ingenuity for in order to get the rewards that we need. So there's a small link to the website down below. The chair of this, the committee for registered reports, is Chris Chambers, who's a neuroscientist in the UK. And this committee has gotten so far 38 different journals to adopt registered reports as a publishing option. And you can see the list here. They're mostly in the behavioral sciences and neuroscience, because that's where Chris and I and some of the others on the team have been, so we've had the most direct impact on. But there is a journal that is doing this across all areas of science. The Royal Society Open Science is now accepting submissions for registered reports in any area of science. So if you want to try it out as a model, try out the Royal Society's journal. The opportunity is to learn a lot about whether having these commitments up front not just change the incentives for researchers, but also the reproducibility of the outcomes. And so we have evaluation processes in place to try to evaluate the effectiveness of registered reports on this. I'll also note that you may see a strong parallel in registered reports in how that review process occurs and how grant review occurs, right? It's supposedly the same thing, right? You do review importance of question and quality of designs prior to knowing what the outcome's for. That's what the money's for in order to get the outcomes. So one of the very interesting opportunities with registered reports, where we have a lot of enthusiasm from both journals and funders now, and we're just trying to figure out how to coordinate it, is that it becomes a partnership between funders and journals. The same submission is evaluated by a funder to fund it and a journal to accept it. And if they both agree, then the money arrives, you do the experiment, and it's published. Right? Everybody wins. Right? It reduces the times that you have to go through a peer review process. For the researcher, it reduces the uncertainty of whether it will get through the peer review process at the end. The funder is delighted because so often research is funded and never actually appears in a journal. This guarantees an outlet. And journals are delighted that they get to publish funded research that they know will be done and be done with high quality. So that has big opportunity, I think, to simplify and actually improve a lot of these processes. Okay, all of those are efforts to try to diversify the means with which people can be rewarded and the rewards that they receive. So those are illustrations of that, and there are many others that we can imagine and discuss. What I want to spend the rest of my time on is to talk about our broader strategy. What we've reviewed so far is working on the incentives directly, but as I mentioned, 3/4 of our team are actually building technology. And this is what we see as the long-term means of improving openness and reproducibility, is providing public goods infrastructure to try to make it easy for researchers to be more open and reproducible in their work. And then the incentives make it so that they want to do those things. And so the Center for Open Science only builds free and open source tools and services. So everything I'm describing is no monetization at all. It's just free for the community. And so one of the things that we wanted to solve at the outset, which we think is actually one of the biggest challenges to reproducibility, is the simple fact that we forget and lose stuff. Data in my lab gets lost because people are moving in and out of the lab. There are multiple teams working on different projects. Everybody has their own ad hoc systems for storage. Storage devices crap out. Things get lost, and we can't use them for ourselves. A follow-up study that we want to do, we go back to the original data, and we can't find it. This is incredibly wasteful internally, let alone sharing those results with others once some of the work or none of the work is published. So we wanted to solve that problem, and so we started with that in building the Open Science Framework. The Open Science Framework, you can go osf.io and you can sign up for an account right now. It'll be done Thursday. Well, don't do it right now. Do it right after the talk. And you can get an account, and when you have an account, you can create projects. And then you add collaborators to those projects. And then you can dump data and materials and protocols and anything else into those projects that are stored in the cloud with very strong redundancy and security standards. And you can do all of that privately. You don't have to make any of it public. So what it provides as a value for the laboratory is a way to make sure that nothing gets lost again. So as long as each member of the lab adds the appropriate personnel to those projects, then even when that person leaves the lab, they'll still have access and be able to find those projects and those materials and those data. And so as a service, that solves this forgetting and losing problem. But simultaneously, we make it trivial to make that material publicly accessible. So for one project, we might have a great methodology that we think others might have a use for, but we don't want to make the data available because it has some human subjects information, so the privacy issue for sharing that. So the projects are organized so that we can make just parts of it publicly accessible. So we go to the materials component, we say, click the button in the corner, it says make public. And then it says, are you really sure you want to make it public? And if I say yes, make it public, then that's public. And the data stay private. And so what that allows is an integration of that private workflow that is we're using for lab management purposes with a public workflow that makes that available and discoverable by anybody that wants to make use of that, cite that, and extend the work that we have done. By integrating those workflows, we can reduce the barrier to openness because now it's just a matter of a click rather than a planning process and figuring out how is it that I'm going to prepare that material to be useful for others or where am I going to make it available. It's just a matter of saying make it available. So that is a basic thing that we try to solve with the Open Science Framework. But it feeds into a much broader project that we have in trying to open all of science. And I'm sure you're very familiar with open access, the goal of making the outcomes of research, the reports themselves, publicly accessible. And open data has also matured as a concept where we are looking for ways to make the content of research available, the data that was generated and the materials that generated that data, the code that was involved. But there's also a potential for making the process of producing those outputs available, the workflow, the pre-registration, how it is that we got from point A to point B to point C. And really, the meat of research is in the content and the process. David Donahoe from Stanford calls papers advertising for the research because it's just how you describe the research that you've done. But really, the research is the data that you produce and the process by which you produced it. And so if that's accessible, then your work is much more reproducible for someone else that wants to try to find those same kinds of things. And they can use that and extend it. So that's the broader goal for the Center for Open Science. And the infrastructure is really designed to facilitate that in our role of creating public goods that connect the different services that researchers use around the entire research life cycle. So this may be a familiar life cycle diagram from an introductory course in any science class, where the ideal of science is you search and discover what has been done, and you develop ideas, then you design the studies, get some materials for it, collect data, store that data somewhere, analyze it, interpret, write a report, publish a report, and then it goes around and around and around. Some people prefer to think of it as a spiral going up, like we're learning something, but it might just be going around and around and around. At every stage of this process, researchers have services that they use, tools that help them to get around that life cycle. And what the Open Science Framework has is an abstracted API, which is Application Programming Interface. This is the way of the modern web. How do you make different services able to talk to each other? And with this abstracted API, any service that can talk to the OSF can talk to any other service that's connected to the OSF. And so we are systematically connecting different services in the life cycle to the OSF so that they can all be interacted with in the same workspace. So that if you are someone that uses Zotero for citation management, for example, and your collaborator uses Google Drive for managing different files, and another collaborator stores data on her Dropbox, and the analyst uses GitHub for generating and storing all the code, all of those can be connected together in a single workflow, and it's very easy to move material in between. And so say that I need to analyze that data, JASP Stats, which is a free open source a GUI interface for data analysis that also does Bayesian analysis. I can access that data trivially through JASP. And when I'm done with the report, I might say, I want to post this stuff to Figshare. So I connect my Figshare account, and I can just move the files, drag and drop from my Dropbox into my Figshare. If we can connect all of these services together, we make the researcher more efficient, and we make that entire life cycle more reproducible. Because where error happens is in the gaps between moving from one service to another. And getting around this life cycle, where we lose information is in that dynamic exchange between collaborators or between the different services that we use that create a lot of friction and a lot of inefficiency and ultimately a lot of error. So connecting it all together creates a history that you can just play back. This is exactly how that project went over time. And we have given, over this last year, grants to a variety of different groups to connect their services to the OSF to start to fill out examples across the entire research lifecycle. So you can imagine, for example, if you use Galaxy as a workflow tool in bioinformatics, you can have that process connected to the data sets that you use with the analytics tools that you use, pushed into the long-term data stores that you might use, and then inject that into the publication process so that the reviewers can even access those data behind the paper that they're reviewing and even rerun the analyses trivially just by being provided the links to see where that happens. So over time, the more and more services that are connected to this, the more that all of those services gain, because any one service then has access to all of the others. So for example, the University of Notre Dame has an excellent computational services platform. And so you can, you know, you set up an analysis, send it to the compute services, and then it sends back the result. They connected that to the Open Science Framework, and then instantly, that compute service had access to all of the data store areas that were connected to the OSF. So any researcher that had data in any of those storage places, all they need to do is call the computational service, reference where the data is in any of those services, and then it grabs the data, does the computation, sends back the result. All right, everybody wins. Okay, you get it. Okay, the bigger picture on what the Open Science Framework is it's a layered set of services. So I know this, I hope this is interesting. It's interesting to some people, it's not at all interesting to other people, like my spouse. Even though she has a lab and she uses it, she just does not care about this part. The framework itself is a set of tools and services that are a separate layer from the interface that the user works with. So the framework manages workflow, authentication, who's allowed to access this, like single sign-on from a university, how files are stored, which at small scales is easy, at large scales is a very hard problem, file rendering, database of metadata about things, the integrations of all these services, search tools, and then our shared data set, which is the metadata from all scholarly output. And from that core set of framework, any interface can be built on top of it. And anyone can build a service on top of it because all of this is open source. And so the osf.io website is one interface that accesses all of these services in the back end. But one can also create a journal that accesses all of those interfaces, or a registry that accesses those, or preprint services, or grant management. Any different thing, all of these different services use the same kind of infrastructure, the same tools and technologies, where the community that wants those things, these core technologies are not their expertise or their interest, it is in how they use them, how they engage the interface between their community and what they're trying to do. So they shouldn't have to reinvent the solutions to all of these problems. We provide that back end, and then the communities can focus their resources on creating the right interface, how is it that our journal should operate for our community, and the outreach into that community to try to get people involved, invested, and engaged in that service. So this lowers dramatically the overall cost because there's centralized services for those back-end infrastructures and puts them into very modern standards. So to illustrate this with one of our interventions, application framework is a set of tools like this as one layer, and that can all be called by interfaces of different kinds, and we have a number of different interfaces. And because we have no monetization, we can give that interface to communities so that they can brand it for themselves. So a service like OSF preprints can be branded as other community services that they operate, and we are simply the technology partners for it. So one of those exists, OSF preprints. So you can go to osf.io/preprints, and this is a general open preprint service that aggregates data from all the other preprint services that we can find and connect to the shared database. So data from Archive or BioArchive or PeerJ or SciArchive or EngArchive or the new ChemArchive, when it exists, all gets aggregated through a central search and discovery layer. And through that, you can also post new preprints to the OSF, or you can create branded versions of that service for that community that community then moderates itself based on the standards in that community. So we have partners with SociArchive, EngArchive, and SciArchive, and we're talking to all of the other major groups, including Archive for Physics, which is the most long-standing preprint service. They need to redo their entire infrastructure. It's based on very old technologies. That's amazing how they've kept it running this long. It is fantastic. They are a fabulous group. But we are talking to them about whether they want to move on to this service to operate Archive. But that can be extended very easily, because that same core set of tools as the application framework can be used for other interfaces, like registries. So if different communities want to register, have a registry where people document what studies they're going to do and their confirmatory analysis plans that they're going to do them, then they can use what hasn't been released yet, but OSF registries, and then create branded versions for their communities. So we have three partnerships already for this service for when it comes out that will use OSF registries as their service provider. And this can be done so much more efficiently in terms of cost. Their grants can be for their community engagement and how they operate their service and moderate it with a small amount of resources supporting the infrastructure itself that's spread across the many different services that are using common tools.
Okay.
Oh, a pre-reg challenge is one illustration of using this service. Okay, so for us, what this helps with is each of these services, registries or institutions or repositories, or OSF for meetings, a way to make it easy to share presentations and posters for conferences, all of them are ways to increase sharing at different stages of the research lifecycle that make it very easy to get into that lifecycle with one action that the person wants to do. I want to share this poster. And then invite them to start to connect other things that are linked to that project, the data that they have, a registration that they did, a report, a preprint that they have. And connecting those things together then makes that data more curated, more discoverable, more accessible, and more useful for others. So that's the long-term vision for the Center for Open Science. And it's based on sort of three strategic principles. Develop technology to enable change, to increase openness, transparency, and reproducibility. I didn't talk about it, but we offer free training services so people know how to be more open and reproducible in their work, and that can be done via webinar and otherwise, so if you want that for a lab or department, just follow up. And incentives to embrace that, that it's not a career loss for me to be practicing more openly and transparently, but in fact, there are reasons that I can gain from that, and there's lots of things that we can discuss about that. But just that infrastructure isn't sufficient because those incentives are maintained by many different parts of the scientific ecosystem. It can't be just journals and publishers that start to have nudges to increase transparent practices, because if the universities don't have any interest in that, if they just say, we still will only keep the people that produce the most publications in Cell, Nature, and Science, then the incentives will remain the same for the researcher. Simultaneously, if funders are rewarding productivity, output, rather than the quality, the reproducibility, the standards, then the system won't change. So this is a coordination problem. It requires all different groups to think about how they can nudge their own incentives to reinforce the values of science being rewarded in the everyday practice of science. And so what I'd like to close with is something that is an action step. What can you do? So if you are a researcher or like researchers, you can do a few simple things, right? You could try out the OSF, just sign up for an account. You can try the pre-reg challenge as an experiment and see what value it provides, if any. And if it doesn't, then we want to hear about it, especially because we need the disconfirmatory evidence to our initial hypotheses. And you could share a preprint. You've got preprints. You've written things. Put it up there. Funders, there's the top guidelines that can be adopted. Grants can be given for replications to try to incentivize doing replication, at least on occasion. And registered report partnerships with journals. If you're interested in that, definitely talk to me. Editors, we have badges, registered reports, and top guidelines that your journals could adopt. For departments, we can offer workshops, and you can start thinking about hiring and promotion criteria. What goes out in an advertisement for hiring? What's emphasized as the things that this department values in terms of the people and how it decides who to hire or not. And if you like the things that we're doing, we have a cause ambassador program where we provide information and training and swag to ambassadors to be able to spread the word at their organizations. So I will end with that, you can look at pictures of the Center for Open Science, and I'll be happy to answer questions. Thanks very much for your time and attention.